Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. The first item on the agenda is that we have consideration of whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. 4 is to consider the evidence we'll hear today in relation to the outcomes of COP15. Item 5 is the consideration of a draft report on the Energy Bill. And item 6 is the consideration of the committee's work programme. Are we all agreed to take these items in private?
Agreed.
We are agreed. So items 4, 5 and 6 will be taken in private. Our next item is agenda item 2, which is the evidence session as part of our scrutiny of the outcomes of the 15th UN Biodiversity Conference, otherwise known as COP15. I refer members to the papers that they've received for this item. In the summit in Montreal, a new global framework was agreed for halting and reversing biodiversity loss across the world. To take stock of COP15 and what its outcomes mean for Scotland, the committee will hear from a panel of Scottish and UK based experts in biodiversity policy. And on behalf of the committee, I'm very pleased to welcome Dr. Daniela Diz, Associate Professor of International Ocean Governance, the Lyle, if I got that right, Lyle Centre, Heriot-Watt University, Professor Colin Galbraith, Chair of the Joint Nature Conservation Committee. And I would have liked to have welcomed Professor Peter Hollingsworth, but unfortunately he's been unable to attend due to a family bereavement. I'm sorry for him. And I'm sorry that we're going to miss his evidence. But we have also got Dr. Deborah Lang, the Chief Officer for Scottish Environmental Link. And joining us remotely, we've got Dr. Ruth Mitchell, the Head of Biodiversity and Ecosystems Group, the James Hutton Institute. Thank you all for accepting our invitations, and we're delighted to have you here. There are a series of questions, the first of which is going to come from the Deputy Convener, Fiona Hislop. Fiona.
Good morning, and thank you very much for joining us today. Looking at COP15 and the outcomes, in terms of translating these outcomes into actions, how will it be ensured that these targets will be delivered at global level, when obviously previous agreements have failed to do so? And has there been progress with what the global implementation mechanisms for biodiversity should look like? And bearing in mind, we've just seen the signing of the High Seas Treaty at the weekend. I maybe might come to you first, Dr. Daniela Diz, as you're the Associate Professor of International Ocean Governance. So I'll maybe ask you to come in first on that, please.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah, I was just in New York, just back, and so I'm a little bit jet-lagged and all of that. We had to extend our stay in New York until yesterday because of the overnight negotiations. But yeah, previously the IUC biodiversity targets under the Convention on Biological Diversity, none of them had been achieved. But I think that in light of the global biodiversity framework that was adopted in COP15, I think there has been some strengthening of the processes for implementation and reporting that's a little bit different from the previous IUC biodiversity targets. So I think that provides an enhanced opportunity for countries, state parties, to actually implement the global biodiversity framework as opposed to the previous globally agreed targets. And of course, the treaty that was, the text of the treaty in New York that was agreed upon, not yet adopted, but agreed upon, can help with the implementation of the global biodiversity framework as well. The Convention on Biological Diversity applies to both areas within and beyond national jurisdiction. So the High Seas Treaty has, if it enters into force before 2030, because all the targets of the Global Biodiversity Framework are supposed to be implemented by 2030. So hopefully the agreement in New York will be entering into force before then in order to help achieve those targets, especially Target 3 on marine protected areas in general, and other effective area-based conservation measures, and also Target 14 on mainstreaming biodiversity into policies and so on, which includes, for example, environmental impact assessments and strategic environmental assessments.
And just sticking on the High Seas Treaty, clearly Scotland's waters go way extensively into the Atlantic. So there are obviously issues about near shore, but also, as you said, that kind of international connections where, you know, we've got the High Seas Treaty in particular. So what do you think that, what implications do you think that has for Scotland?
I think it's a positive outcome because it can protect, it can prevent harm from transboundary harm as well. So some of the implications would be that activities even that could take place within national jurisdiction that could have an effect on areas beyond national jurisdiction, would there's strengthened mechanisms for sharing environmental impact assessments and making sure that some of those activities don't pose threat in areas beyond national jurisdiction. Decision-making will still be at the national level. There's no global-level decision-making, but mm-hmm. there's still mechanisms for enhancing information sharing, consultation on impact assessments, also from other nations that could pose impacts on areas beyond national jurisdiction, including the high seas and also activities on the high seas that could pose threat within national jurisdiction. So, and also marine protected areas on the high seas that could protect some of the biodiversity that would benefit Scotland because ecosystems don't know jurisdictional boundaries. So in that, from that sense, I think it's a positive outcome.
And thank you very much for joining us, coming from New York, as you have. Can I maybe come to Colin Galbraith, and again, more broadly, why do you think that the COP15 outcomes have got more chance to get delivered than perhaps previous agreements have?
Yeah, I think they have got more chance to have been implemented, but it's still a challenge, and it's a challenge at the global level, because historically we've not, around the world, we've probably not monitored and reported properly. And I think the opportunity now is with regular reporting, hopefully every 2 years back to CBD, to the convention, and effective monitoring, then there is more information coming through and there's more opportunity to comment in the years ahead. But if you look at the targets that are in there, take one, for example, by 2030 to have 30% land and sea protected areas, that actually is only 7 years away. Mm-hmm. So we need to take action now and be seen to take action now, not just in Scotland, but globally. And I think really the key here is about reporting and monitoring to make sure that we've got data and information going in for regular reporting, regular discussion at the global level. So it is still a challenge. I go from days where you're optimistic about the delivery to pessimistic about the delivery at the global level. And I think we really need to keep our eye on the ball here in terms of what the United Nations does and how it coordinates that reporting. So I think I'm giving half an answer that says it's a real challenge. You know, we've still got to learn from previous mistakes going forward. But the CBD targets are a fantastic step forward. You know, they're very clear in terms of global wording. They're very ambitious in terms of global wording. So I think there is an opportunity now in the next year or two to really, you know, push forward on that delivery.
And Dr. Deborah Long, can I maybe ask you if you've got any comments on the global implementation and what you think about the COP15 outcomes?
I agree that I think it's the scale of the challenge, really, that's pulling people together. And I think that's why we stand a much better chance this time of mm-hmm. making progress, because everyone is aware of the scale of the challenge and the fact we're going to have to work together. If I can give you a little bit of a homework, there's a Wild Isles series coming up on BBC that starts on Sunday. I would definitely recommend you watch that. It's UK-wide, but most of it will be filmed in Scotland, I'm sure. And it will give you a real insight into why we need to be acting now and why the Global Biodiversity Framework is so important. In terms of translating it into what happens in Scotland, I think it is ambitious, there's no doubt about it. But the things that are good about it is that it's action-focused. So if you look at the targets, they're very action-focused, which is great. But there is clearly a need for speed. As Colin said, there's only, in effect, 7 growing seasons before 2030. If you're a gardener, if you're a forester, if you're a farmer, 7 growing seasons is nothing. So that really underlines the need for speed and for action. And the ways we can achieve that is to mainstream biodiversity so that it achieves the same level of power, if you like, as the climate change plan, for example. We can make sure that it gets delivered right across Scotland, so it's not just stuck in one or two divisions. And we need to bring people on board, which is where I think programmes like Wild Isles will really help, because it really illustrates why we need to act now.
And can maybe bring in Dr. Mitchell remotely, if you've got any comments about the global implementation.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I think it's really nice ambitions there, but I think the real key is going to be the implementation of them and the actual action that takes place. So Deborah's already mentioned the importance of mainstreaming across different departments. And I think that's something that's really important, not just at the global level, but also, you know, locally in Scotland as well. So getting biodiversity up there across all different departments. So it's not just seen as something for sort of the people directly involved in the environment, but people involved in business and economics and society, that biodiversity is up there with the climate crisis. So I think that's my first point. I think the targets need to be translated into SMART targets so that they're very specific and measurable and achievable and time-bound. We've already heard the importance of making sure they're time-bound. And then, as has already been mentioned, we need the appropriate sort of funding and monitoring to actually achieve those targets. So, yeah, making sure, translating those targets into things that are actionable, and the funding and the monitoring, I think, is really important.
And it would be helpful for you to advise us what that might look like in terms of our ongoing scrutiny. And can I maybe now come to Colin? You might be able to help us with giving a view on what influence or leadership did the Scottish Government, or indeed Scottish institutions, including our scientific community, provide at COP15 or the run-up to negotiations, which is a key period? And, for example, what impact did the Edinburgh Declaration have?
Yeah, thanks for that. I chair the UK Joint Nature Conservation Committee, so I have to be evenly spread across the UK in terms of what I say, but I may be slightly biased towards Scotland, I have to say. I mean, I think what's happened prior to CBD, we at the UK level produced a joint statement from the four agencies, so from Nature Scot, Natural England, NRW in Wales and Northern Ireland. And that statement really sort of laid out key issues that should be addressed at CBD. And I think then following that up with the presence of the minister at the conference itself and with the Edinburgh Declaration really had an impact. And I think it's about using the Scottish expertise, universities, institutes, into nature conservation that's the real trick here. And I think a lot of my work historically has been on the translation from the academic scientific world into practical conservation action. And I think what you saw in the lead up to the Montreal conference was very much that Scottish input into a UK discussion and then into a global discussion. In terms of leadership generally, the reality is the world does look to Scotland in terms of leading in terms of nature conservation. And I think historically we've looked at many issues around species management, land use management, marine conservation in particular that we've heard about as well. So we have, I think, in the next year or two, a real opportunity to take what we're doing here in Scotland and come on to the biodiversity strategy itself and to show the world what we're actually doing in a very positive way. Now, that's not saying it's perfect. No country at the minute is perfect in terms of, I don't think, implementing the outcome from the conference. But actually, Scotland, by having a strategy document drafted beforehand that will then modify and develop as we begin to digest the targets properly, is in a really good position, actually, to influence that wider debate going forward. And that wider debate, from my perspective, is both within the wider UK. And then our remit in JNCC is very much to take that into the global discussion, the global discussions that will happen over the next year or two. So I think what I'm saying, Scotland has been hugely influential. The potential is there to be as influential going forward, but we've got to keep our eye on the ball in terms of what we're trying to do here, in terms of delivery. One example, we talk about 30% protected areas. Which is a really good target, you know, to put our land and sea area into that sort of scale, 30% protected. But behind that, we've still got to look at, is that being effective? We've still got to look at monitoring. We've still got to look at the species populations, the overall habitat health, to make sure that within protected areas, we are doing the right thing as well. So it's about targets, numerical targets. It's about ecological targets as well, to say what's really happening, and then to make sure that things are really getting better. So we have a history of monitoring really well in Scotland, in the UK. I think there's a real opportunity coming in the next year or two to be more influential than maybe we have been.
Danielle, I see you nodding. Perhaps you might want to comment.
Sure, yeah, I think that one strength of the Edinburgh process as well has been not only the adoption of the Global Biodiversity Framework in terms of its own decision, decision 15/4, but also COP decision 15/12, which was around subnational governments also having a voice in the whole process and in the implementation and reporting and monitoring of the Global Biodiversity Framework, and the commitment from the party, so the UK is a party to the convention, to actually work with Scotland and others, other nations, to actually report as a whole on the implementation and make sure that that happens. So there are a few time frames that I think we should watch for in terms of complying with what was agreed upon in Montreal. The NBSAPs, the National Biodiversity plans and strategies that the UK will have to update and review to align with the Global Biodiversity Framework is due by COP16. So that will be in the fall of 2024. So working, you know, making sure that Scottish the UK government as a whole is working together with the Scottish government will be very important in that respect, to make sure that the strategy, the Scottish strategy, for example, is taken into consideration in the NBSAPs as a whole. And also in terms of reporting, there are two important dates. 2026 will be the first stocktake type of reporting deadline for at the CBD, and then 2029. So making sure that whatever we do here in Scotland in terms of reporting and review mechanisms align with those timeframes, I think will be important as well.
And can I maybe ask Dr. Rhys Mitchell about Scottish institutions and their role in the lead up to COP? And afterwards, and perhaps you might want to reflect on what contribution your own institution had.
I think certainly the research institutions play an invaluable role in providing the underpinning research to underpin the understanding of some of the biodiversity crisis. So looking at the impacts of both direct drivers on biodiversity, such as pollution or climate change or land use, but also the indirect drivers, so the sort of societal changes that drive biodiversity loss indirectly. At the James Hutton Institute, we've done a lot of work in relation to peatlands and carbon storage, which is important not only for the climate crisis, but also for the biodiversity crisis as well, and for the biodiversity that's imported in those habitats. But we also do a lot of work on a lot of other habitats as well, in terms of looking at many of our vulnerable habitats in Scotland, such as our Atlantic rainforests, how we can restore them. So I think it's really important that we have that underpinning research to understand how the biodiversity is changing and why it's changing, and then what we can do to try and reverse those changes, and also to provide the monitoring to look at the success of actually developing monitoring techniques to monitor the success of the restoration and the implementation we're putting in place. Because there's a lot of new techniques out there that we can now use nowadays to try and monitor biodiversity.
And just finally, if I ask you, Deborah, is what do you see Scotland's place is internationally and globally in the biodiversity crisis, both in the lead-up and outcomes from COP15? Where do you see Scotland globally?
There's just two quick points that I would make. One is, I think Scotland is showing the way through the Edinburgh Declaration. So bringing, Scotland has lots of opportunities to bring national, local, regional authorities, organisations together to work together to be able to deliver the targets. And that's shown very well in the Edinburgh Declaration, which when you think about it, bringing the subnational, regional, local, city authorities together, between them, they manage an awful lot of land and a lot of biodiversity. So their contribution together through the Edinburgh Declaration will be a big step forward, I think, for the Global Biodiversity Framework. The second way I think Scotland can demonstrate leadership is by testing out approaches. And one of the key areas, I think, is when you look at the pattern of land ownership, that we're going to need to find ways of building nature networks to reconnect nature together, and that's going to have to cross ownership boundaries. So I think there's a great opportunity there for Scotland to be able to demonstrate what that looks like, because it's not going to be an easy thing to do, but because of the way Scotland is set up and because of the way Scotland can put in place mechanisms that ensure regional, local, land managers and owners and local communities come together, I think there's a good chance there for Scotland to be able to test the approach and show what can be done.
interesting point about international convenership, I think, that you're making. Thank you. Pass back to convener.
Thank you very much. And I'd like to apologise at this stage. My good manners deserted me at the start of the session when I should have welcomed Mercedes Villalba, who's joining the committee today. I will give you some chance to answer questions at the end, and I'm sorry for not introducing you earlier. My mistake. The next questions come from Liam.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Panel. Dr. Mitchell, I'll come to you first. You talked about implementation of the COP15 outcomes, and you talked about translating into smart targets, making things achievable and time-bound, and you talked about funding and monitoring. Do you think that the new biodiversity strategy and delivery plan align to the GBF targets and indeed those items that you've spoken about, and how translatable actually are the targets coming out of COP15 into domestic Scottish policy?
I think the key will be in the delivery plan. So we have the draft Scottish strategy, and I know that it was only draft, so they've got time to try and translate the outcomes of COP15 into that strategy. But the key is really in the delivery plan, because the strategy at the moment, I think, still has some further work to do on it to make it perhaps as smart and as specific for those targets as we need. I think I understand from Nature Scott that they have started translating across from the targets from COP15 to the biodiversity strategy. But I think perhaps those links need to be made really clear. And I definitely think there's further work to be done in terms of making the targets smarter, in terms of making them more specific and targeted and time-bound.
Thank you. Deborah Long, we've only got 7 years. So Dr. Mitchell's talked about how more must be done and we need to get the plan together. Deborah Long, have we got time, really?
Time is definitely short. We should have been doing an awful lot more before now, but we are where we are. So there are definitely areas where we can and we must pick up the speed. And I think the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy is a good start. As Dr. Mitchell says, it's the delivery plans that are going to be really key. If they're in 5-year delivery plans, which they will be, the first delivery plan takes us practically up to 2030. So that delivery plan has to hit the ground running. It has to have the specific smart targets, but it also needs to bring everyone on board, because this can't be delivered by Nature Scott on its own or any of the public agencies on their own. So it needs to bring everyone on board. And I think there are certain mechanisms that we can make sure that we bring enough people into this to achieve the speed and the momentum that we need within the next 5 years. And one of that is mainstreaming. So it's not just the Environment Directorate that's concerned with this, but MPF4, for example, is helping to contribute towards the targets. The land use strategy is helping to contribute to the targets. One of the biggest things we could do in Scotland is to really tackle the deer management issue in the uplands, because that would address one of the targets that the clerks pulled out for discussion today in terms of halting biodiversity loss in biodiversity-rich areas. If we could tackle that, that would take us a long way towards where we need to be in 2030. There are lots of other examples, but I think the key thing is let's mainstream it, let's take responsibility for it at cabinet level so that everyone out there can see that this is really, really important and we do want to meet the targets, and let's bring as many people on board as possible, because we all need to be involved in delivering this if we're going to be successful, which we need to be.
And I think the worry seems to be if there is a degree of complacency. And one of the things, Colin Galbraith, that I would like to explore, you said earlier on, the world does look to Scotland to show the world what we're doing, which I found quite surprising. Given there was mention made of the Aichi targets, and Scotland failed to meet the Aichi targets. 9 of the 20, I think, were met, and the ones that were met were personal view perhaps, but not perhaps quite the key ones that we need to be meeting. So on that note then, Colin Galbraith, the GBF talks about increasing the ambition on finance for biodiversity. Target 19 actually talks about scaling up finance for biodiversity. We've just had a budget. In your view, has that been met?
I think there are several issues in there. I mean, the world does look to the UK and it does look to Scotland for examples and for leadership. I'm convinced of that, having worked in international nature conservation for about 30-plus years. And we do have something to offer in there in terms of the historic approach to nature conservation. I think where we are now, as Deborah said, in terms of that mix of land use, species management, terrestrial and marine, there's something we can offer to say, well, look, this is how we're doing it. What do you think to the other world? On finance, there's never enough money going into nature conservation. It's as basic as that. I think when you look at the new framework that we have from CBD, we will undoubtedly focus on the 2030 targets, and rightly, but actually there are 2050 targets in there as well that are more profound. And just to read a little bit, by 2050, the integrity, connectivity and resilience of ecosystems will be maintained, enhanced and restored. That is a huge, that's goal A in the new agreement. That is a huge challenge. So I think we've got to do several things. One is absolutely look after what we have now. As Deborah said, we're only 7 years up to 2030, but let's really protect and look after what we have right now, because for the next 5 to 7 years, this is it. This is what we're going to have. Then by 2030, let's get the innovative plan that the strategy is beginning to build towards in place, but also keep our eye on that longer 2050 plan, which, again, the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy is 2045. There is a longer-term view there. But actually, each of these time phases becomes really important, and really important that more resource comes into it progressively. So are we in the right place now? No, I don't think any country is, frankly, following the Montreal Agreement in terms of finances. I think we've got to look and make clear arguments as to why very scarce budget should be deployed in this way. And it is about quality of life, it is about maintaining green space, it is about looking after our fresh water, our uplands, our marine environment, for the good of people and for the good of nature. We are entirely dependent on the ecosystems round about us. And it's how we get that message over that will then hopefully lead to greater resource coming in. But there is one enormous job to do across the whole of government, in Scotland and in other countries, to deliver that.
Thank you. Daniela Diz, I'll make this the last question for just now. Are there any priorities or targets that this committee needs to be particularly aware of, that we need to be saying that is the key target we need to prioritise, or are there any targets that will be particularly difficult to be achieved in your view that this committee needs to be focusing on?
Thank you. I think that in terms of prioritization, I think just building on what Colin was saying, there is a lot that Scotland has been doing already, and more focus also on the biodiversity strategy could put efforts on to build upon what has been achieved. One of the things that is referred to in the strategy, but perhaps not so much, is blue carbon, and it's important for this committee in terms of delivering nature-based solutions. And even though salt marshes is referred to, and there are a number of places it's referred to, also peatlands, of course, super important, but in terms of carbon sink, there are other ecosystems and marine ecosystems. Scottish Government has done audits, for example, in the Orkney, identifying several other marine ecosystems that play a very important role in carbon sink and storage. And it's much broader than salt marshes and seagrasses. So it goes on to kelp, bryozoans, brittle star ecosystems, a number of others. So making sure that its strategy rightly says that it will be identifying ecosystems for restoration and protection, but looking into through the lens of also blue carbon and ensuring that nature-based solutions. So that's in relation to Target 8, but it also is across cutting issue, I think, that you can integrate that into Target 3 on marine protected areas and other effective area-based conservation areas. Other effective area-based conservation measures is also an area that I think is growing in attention globally. FAO has produced guidelines for fishery sector, for example, to align with the CBD criteria from 2018 on other effective area-based conservation measures, or OECMs, and that could also be further explored in more in-depth, either through the delivery plans or further elaborated in the strategy. It's also related to Target 3 on 30 by 30 because it's marine protected areas terrestrially, and OECMs that will help achieve that 30 by 30. Target 1 also on spatial planning. Scotland has done a lot with respect to marine spatial planning, and I think that the qualifiers in Target 1, integrated, equitable, biodiversity inclusive marine spatial planning, is also an area that Scotland could lead and help lead and provide leadership to the world. And of course, Target 2 on restoration, I think the biodiversity strategy, the Scottish one, has put a lot of emphasis on restoration, ecological restoration, and I think in light of all of those different ecosystems, it's an area that Scotland can provide leadership. And Target 5 is not really mentioned in the strategy as far as I could see, and it relates to fisheries. Of course, forestry as well, but fisheries is not explicitly mentioned in Target 5 at the moment, but it does. You can look at, if you look at it, it talks about bycatch, it talks about ecosystem protection of ecosystem, vulnerable ecosystem. So those type of terms are already included in the strategy, but it doesn't refer to Target 5. An ecosystem approach to fisheries, for example, ecosystem of implementation of ecosystem approach more broadly. And as Deborah mentioned, mainstreaming of biodiversity across all sectors, across all policies and legislation is really key, and that's Target 14. So I think it is challenging. All of those are challenging areas as well, but I think those are areas that Scotland has been providing leadership, but it could be further enhanced to show the world. And just one final thing on Target 14, I think it's really, CBD has adopted guidelines on voluntary guidelines previously in the past on biodiversity inclusive environmental impact assessments and biodiversity inclusive strategic environmental assessments for both terrestrial and marine ecosystems. And I think, you know, taking a look at those guidelines and seeing how that could be integrated into UK and Scottish legislation would be a step forward towards the implementation of Target 14 on mainstreaming.
Very grateful. Unless anyone else wants to respond to that question, I'll hand back to convener.
Thank you very much, Liam. We're going to come back to Fiona for another question. Fiona.
So the two of the notable targets of the global framework are the 30 by 30 target and the restoration target. And obviously for restoration to be completed or underway on at least 30% of degraded terrestrial, inland and coastal marine ecosystems. So what scale of the challenges that is this? And I also declare I'm the nature champion for Scotland's extraordinary blanket bogs, and obviously our peatland restoration is absolutely huge, so interested to hear what you say about that in particular. But what scale of challenges does this bring us for biodiversity conservation in Scotland? And if you can maybe be a bit more specific now about what type of programmes you would expect to be seeing for us to be meeting those targets by 30 by 30 and the restoration target. And if I maybe come to you first, Dr. Ruth Mitchell, if that's okay, and then to Deborah.
Thank you very much. I think the real key here is the word effective in the target, because I think it's very easy for things to be protected on paper, but for that not to actually have the effect actually on the ground. So I think there's a lot of work going on to work out how we might sort of designate or protect on paper 30%, but the key is going to be making sure that that's really effective. So already in many of our protected areas, we've got land that's protected, but there's still many damaging activities going on both on protected land and in protected sea areas. So it's not just about the designation, it's about what actually implementing that on the ground that I think is really key.
And Deborah,
would
do you
be my first point.
Yeah, is there anything else you want to say, Dr. Mitchell?
No, sorry, Deborah.
Okay.
So on 30 by 30, there are three elements, really, that we need to consider as part of 30 by 30. It is a big challenge, and what it's going to take is that we need to expand from, if we take the land example, for example, about 17% of Scotland's land at the moment is designated and protected and managed for nature. To increase that to 30,000, we're looking at a number of almost 980,000 hectares needs to come into protection for nature. So that's a big challenge. It's not impossible, because within that, we can start to look at the OECMs that Daniela mentioned. So that can help, but it is a big challenge to expand that area. We then need to improve the condition of the protected areas that we already have. They're not as good as they could be, and we need to be making sure that external impacts that are impacting on protected areas are minimised, so they're not having as much of an impact, and the other areas that we need to start to connect them together. And connectivity, ecological connectivity between protected areas and the areas outside, and between habitats outside protected areas, is going to be the fundamental thing, in my view, that will take us towards ecological resilience. And that's what we need for the future. We need our ecosystems to be resilient so they can continue to maintain the ecosystem services that we all rely on, not just species and green access to nature for our health and our mental well-being, but it's also flooding, it's also productive soils, it's also pollination. It's all of those things that we need to build. And I think connectivity is going to be one of the biggest elements of that. In terms of nature restoration, we need to be looking both at habitats and species. There is more that we think we can do on the species side in the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy. The target in the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy isn't as ambitious as the one in the Global Biodiversity Framework, so we think that needs to have a bit more of a look at. And then in terms of how we actually do that, one obvious area of work is looking at the agricultural subsidy, because that, to come back to the finance point, that is a portion of money of which needs to go towards conserving biodiversity on the ground. And by that, what we're calling for from Link is to put 70% of that funding, to work towards 70% of that funding going towards nature and climate-friendly farming. If we do that, then that means we're also contributing towards the 30 by 30 target for farmland. And farmed land across Scotland is about 70% of our landscape. So that's a big chunk. Then, of course, we've got woodland, we've got forestry strategy up for review at the moment. Very, very welcome to see that. And the more we can use that to be looking at natural regeneration, to connect our areas of forestry together, to look at including more native species, to look at making sure that schemes that happen are assessed on a long enough time scale that people will actually go in for them. So, for example, at the moment, if you go for a natural regeneration scheme, you've only got 5 years to prove that's going to work. 5 years isn't very long for a forester. That needs to be much longer. It needs to be something like 15, so that people are more encouraged to go for it. Then two other quick points. Upland, I've already mentioned deer. If we can tackle the deer, the distribution and the number of deer across Scotland at the moment, that means that we will be bringing an awful lot of our uplands back into better condition. So we'd be looking at Arctic heath, we'd be looking at lichen communities on the Cairngorm Plateau, for example, we'd be looking at montane woodlands, we'd be looking at peatlands. All of those things would benefit from having lower deer densities.
And could I just ask you, Deborah, we've heard from Liam in his questioning about public finance. There's also an understanding that private finance would need to be mobilised to get anywhere near
Absolutely.
Some of these targets. And there's obviously question marks as to whether that's been done in an appropriate way in terms of international carbon offsetting, etc.
Yes.
But can you maybe give me your personal view, or indeed Scottish Environmental Link's view, as to whether or not we should and be using private finance to do some of this restoration, and what would be the optimum programme that is equitable but also reflects the need to meet these targets but to have balance in that finance system for the private interests, which are obviously extensively investing, as we've just seen recently?
I don't think we'll do it without private finance, to be honest. There just isn't going to be enough public funding to be able, and charitable funding to be able to tackle this. So I think we do need to look at private finance. I think we need to be careful, and we need to learn the lessons of the 80s so that we don't end up in situations where we've got a lot of forestry being put on peaks, for example. So we need to learn those lessons. In terms of the balance, there is obviously got to be a very clear balance between benefits to the local community of private finance within going into nature and climate schemes, but we also need to be putting in place risk management strategies so that private finance is actually benefiting biodiversity and carbon, and there are a few mechanisms that we do need government to be putting in place so that we know that we are, that private finance is going into the right kind of action in the right kind of place. So there's the right tree, right place mm-hmm. argument. There's also how do local communities benefit from that? It's a global benefit. If you're conserving ecosystems, how do the local communities benefit from that? And how do we distribute the benefits of private finance coming into a biodiversity credit market, which is not well developed at the moment? There's a big, big role there for government to make sure that any biodiversity credit market, and we're still doing the thinking on what this might look like, but it has to ensure that what comes out at the end is restoring nature into the long term. So any scheme that just looks at 5 years or 10 years, if you're looking at a financial timescale, then 10 years is pretty good. Yeah. But if you're looking on an ecological timescale, then 10 years is the blink of an eye. So it's trying to match up those two timescales, and I think there's a really important role there for government to look at the risk in terms of time and scale of action as well, because we want it to be spread across the landscape and across local communities so that everyone benefits from it.
And with the convener, if I can bring in the other, are we okay for time?
But we're fine, Deputy Convener.
Daniela, do you want to come in on this and on how what programmes are needed to meet these targets, and if you've had any reflections on what you've heard from the other panellists as well on this point?
Yeah, no, I completely agree with Deborah. I think we need to be careful. We've learned some lessons elsewhere in the world where, you know, the communities have been, especially with mangroves, for example, in some African countries, there's some carbon credit schemes where the local communities weren't very, you know, listened to. So it's important to have all the accountability in place and checks and balances from government to make sure that private financing is streamlined in a way that doesn't undermine local interests and local communities' interests. But I think I agree that there is need for private financing. In the interface between the CBD and the UNFCCC, I think what was achieved in Montreal can really enhance what has been ongoing at UNFCCC. There is a dialogue between oceans and UNFCCC going on at the moment. And even though the IPCC has only developed methodologies for assessing carbon sinks and also emissions from degraded areas for in terms of marine ecosystems, especially for salt marshes, seagrasses, and mangroves, there is an opportunity now that with the CBD that those other blue carbon ecosystems that we mentioned before can also be further developed in terms of scientific methodology for assessing their role in carbon sink, but also in biodiversity benefits and mm-hmm. ecosystem services. So I think that the GBF has provided that bridge, I think, that is needed between the climate regime and the biodiversity regime. And there is a lot of opportunity to build on that, but with caution and I think with the government playing an important role in terms of regulation and ensuring the checks and balances in place so that nature-based solutions can be, you know, in the definition that was adopted by UNEA last year or the year before, I think it was last year, can also be achieved in that context. So it doesn't, nature-based solutions doesn't harm biodiversity because there isn't a you know, there was one of the fears with the term nature-based solutions. It needs to be increasing biodiversity, actually, and biodiversity positive outcomes rather than something that uses nature, but it could pose a threat as well, but also for the benefit of local communities and everyone.
Do you think Scotland's underdeveloped in utilising its marine assets or seas around us for that twin-track approach of tackling biodiversity loss, the crisis there, but also the climate crisis in terms of that carbon sink aspect?
I think so, but I think Scotland is not alone. And all nations in the world, I think, have underutilized that. But I think that the studies that Scotland has been put forward, I think, can be built upon. And really, Scotland has a great opportunity to provide leadership to the world in this context.
Thank you very much, Camilla.
Okay, there are some supplementaries on this. I think Mark has got one and Jackie's got one, and then we're going to Mark for some questions that he's got. But Deborah, because you mentioned the word agricultural subsidies, I think it's only fair that I remind the committee that I am part of a family farming partnership. We are in receipt of agricultural subsidies, and we are managing land and woodland, just so there's no dubiety about that. But it has been declared to the committee before, and it is on my register of interest. So I'm going to go to Mark for your supplementary, and then over to Jackie.
Thanks for that reminder, convener. We've spoken quite a bit about 30 by 30, and that's the headline, I suppose, of the framework. I mean, it does make me think about the other 70% then, and Debbie, you've already spoken about agricultural subsidy reform. I was thinking about the marine space. I mean, is it enough for governments to designate marine protected areas, put in place management measures, police them, or should we really be looking beyond that to wider ecosystem management, looking at the impact, for example, of dredging and trawling on inshore areas? I mean, is there a danger, dare I say it, that the 30 by 30 focuses all the attention on the parks, if you like, and we lose the kind of need for ecological coherency across management of wider seas? Daniela, would you like to come in on that?
Sure, yeah. And I think that was one of the, even in the negotiations of the GBF, it was something that a lot of countries emphasized, that, there's so much push for the 30 by 30 target that some countries felt like, well, what about the rest of the targets? But I think that all of the other targets can really contribute to that other side of the 30 by 30, and they need to be implemented equally. So target one on spatial planning, that's not just for the 30% that will be protected. It's for areas, surrounding that 30 by the rest of it. Everything needs to be sustainably managed. It's 100% sustainable management. We have obligations under the Convention on Biological Diversity in the marine environment. We have obligations under the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea to protect and preserve the marine environment, and it's 100%. So the GBF just tries to, I think, streamline. So what are the priority targets and actions that need to be put in place to implement those legally binding obligations that we have elsewhere or under the convention itself? So target one certainly would contribute to that on spatial planning. Target two on restoration, it's not just focused on the 30% that would be protected, it's also outside. Target four on species, threatened species and other species that need to be conserved, it's not only within the 30% and so on. Fisheries management and forest, in five. And the mainstreaming of biodiversity that we talked about before, target 14, it's across all policies and instruments, so we need to be for everything. So of course the focus has been a lot on 30 by 30, but it is an effort for all targets combined and for the 100% sustainable.
Yeah. Okay, I don't know if others want to briefly add to that, otherwise we'll move on, but okay.
If I could, just briefly, I mean, I think there is a danger. 30 by 30 in itself is a fantastic target and a real step forward. You've got to look at 30 by 30 in the context of climate change as well. And we have the twin emergencies of nature loss and climate change. And how then do we meet the 30 by 30 target? What are we actually protecting? How sustainable is what we protect? So I think 30 by 30 will probably dominate. Hopefully we'll look at the effectiveness and not just the number, if you like, in terms of the scale. But the other parts of the agreement from Montreal are really profound in terms of what they mean for how we manage our land, how we manage our seas. So I think, to your question, is there a danger it dominates? Yes, there is. I think we can have a wider debate and discussion over the years to come. But let's look at it as that twin track of nature loss and climate together. From a nature conservation point of view, that really begs some really profound questions. What are we trying to restore? What level of restoration do we want? how do we prioritise? And these are issues we need to grapple with going forward.
Yeah, long-standing issues in conservation, I think, forever.
Might also refer to Deborah as well. So can I bring Jackie in?
Why not?
Yeah. And just see if we can tie the two up together. Jackie.
Thank you. Yes, if I could come to Deborah, if you don't mind. You've mentioned a couple of times now about deer management.
Yes.
Could you maybe go into more detail about it? You know, could you explain to us what you think the issues are roundabout deer management,
yep,
and what the solutions would you think are needed to address those issues?
Yes, I'd also like to say something about marine as well, but I'll do deer first. So if you look at the State of Nature report, this is produced every 3 years by a community of NGOs, but also includes Nature Scot, Royal Botanic Garden Scotland, so public agencies as well. And that looks at the state of nature across Scotland, and it also looks at key drivers of change. And when you look at the uplands, one of the key drivers of change are deer numbers. And the sort of thing we're looking at is that the carrying capacity of Scottish upland habitat, so we're talking about montane woodlands and above, if you like, it's roughly 5 deer per kilometre. And some areas of Scotland have got 64 deer per kilometre. So when you look at the numbers, if you look at a graph, deer numbers have gone up massively since the 90s. And that's the scale of the problem, really. And the impact that that's having, not just in upland areas, I mean, you see the impact of roe deer, for example, in lowland areas as well. But it means that it limits woodland regeneration. So natural regeneration of trees is very, very difficult when you've got high levels of deer at that number. It also tends to increase where they concentrate erosion. So it's not just deer that do this. Any people, humans, cattle will erode soils if there are too many of them on a single path. You only have to go up a Munro to be able to see that. So what we need to do is, if we can manage the deer populations to bring it down to a carrying capacity, it means those habitats then are in a much better condition to be restored and to hold more of the native species that should be living there. So that's why I think if we can tackle the deer population in Scotland and bring it down to a level that's much closer to the carrying capacity of Scottish habitats, then I think that would be a massive win. Not easy, and I know that what I'm saying is very controversial in some areas. It's not easy, but I think it is a big win that we could have.
And if I remember rightly, figures, what you're saying, is meaning that the deer themselves are starving, if I remember correctly. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's what I found out before.
There is an animal welfare issue there, where you've got too many deer and the habitat just can't support them. So there is it's an environmental issue and it's an animal welfare issue as well, where there are too many deer.
Okay. And just to finish, convener, would your suggestion, would that be a cull that you would suggest, or would that be moving them on to other grounds, if possible?
I think there's too many to keep moving them round, to be honest. And in the absence of... we lost the natural predators to deer a very, very long time ago. So there's all that there is to control them at the moment are humans. So we do need to increase cull levels, I think. And then the other, you've mentioned it already, is that there just isn't enough food for them. Yeah. So, yeah, I think we are looking at deer control. The other advantage of this is at the moment, Scotland puts a huge amount of funding into fencing. If we could divert some of that funding from fencing into deer management, it means that we've got an active, longer-term, larger-scale solution to one of the biggest drivers of change in Scotland's uplands.
OK, thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Back to... Monica.
Can I ask a very brief supplementary one?
I'm sorry, I'm just worried about time.
I don't think my mic's on. Is it on?
Yeah,
okay, sorry. It was just on that. Sorry to grill you now on sustainable deer management, Deborah, but since it's come up, I just wonder, you might not want to put a number on this, but in terms of culling, what is the extent of that? I read recently, I think there's millions of deer in Scotland, but when you're talking about sustainable deer management, is there an optimal number in mind?
It depends on the habitat. So some habitats can carry more deer than others. So it would be very much a situation for each habitat. It would need to be assessed on a on a habitat basis, I'm afraid. So there's no magic number, unfortunately. No simple answer.
Thank you, convener.
Okay, Mark, back to you.
Yes, if I could pick up with the flow for marine, because I think Deborah Long wanted to ask that. I just wanted to ask Dr. Mitchell if she had anything to add on that.
Not on the marine area at all. No. I was going to come back about biodiversity credits at some point, but...
Okay, feel okay. Free.
I was just going to agree that the issue of biodiversity credits is something I think that we as Scotland do need to look into further, because I think there's a danger of multiple different credits being devised and systems being devised, and the potential for unintended consequences if they're not used correctly, and we don't understand the science behind how these credits are being devised. So I think it's really important that we understand that the fundamental science behind how those credits are being calculated. Biodiversity is not simple. With carbon, it is essentially one measure. You can measure carbon, where with biodiversity, you've got a whole range of different species. And if you benefit some species or you benefit some habitats, that might have negative consequences on other habitats. So I think as the potential market for biodiversity credit develops, we really need to be aware of unintended consequences.
Okay. Deborah, can I go back to your marine?
Yes, I was just going to... You asked, is it enough, the 30%? Is it enough to focus on 30 by 30? And no, it's not. The other 70%, we do need to be looking at connecting habitats together, both on land and at sea. But specifically at sea, I wanted to point out that although we've got 37% of Scottish seas under marine protected area designation, if you look at that, less than 1% is strictly protected. But if you look at an example of where it's strictly protected, Lamlash Bay is the example that's always given, the benefits of strictly protecting that area that then gives to local communities, to the fishing community, is significant. So if we do need to expand our less than 1% strict protection up to the 10% within the target, and make sure that the 37% we've already got as marine protected areas are protected for nature, then the benefits are much, much more than just protecting for nature. It benefits local communities, coastal and fishing communities too.
Okay, convener, I'm just going to move on to some other questions around supply chains and consumption. I mean, it's good to see the framework recognising this as an issue. And I suppose every time we buy clothing or we buy food that's been imported, it's always, or even drive an electric car, it's always something that, you know, is forefront of my mind about what is the impact of that wider supply chain on the planet and biodiversity. Have we got enough clarity at the moment about the impact of supply chains and consumption in Scotland? I mean, is there that transparency in terms of corporate reporting or government reporting on this whole area? Colin, did you want to start with that?
If I could maybe make a start on that. I mean, I think the answer to that is no. In JNCC, we've developed an indicator that looks at global consumption, you know, per country, and we did take that to the meeting in Montreal, and it's being used as one of two, I think it is, indicators by CBD in terms of this is how you could calculate your national sort of draw on the world. So we're very happy to circulate details of that round to the committee to let you have a look at that. One of the key targets in the framework is to cut global food waste by half. And you think back to then that consumption indicator, and you think back to the potential damage that could be reduced on the environment if we could cut food waste by half, if we could look at developing a common indicator that's used around the world to tell countries where they're at. That would be a major step forward, and it's certainly something that we will progressively take back to the next CBD COP and the one after as well, in terms of looking at the methodology to do that, because we do need to understand much better our global footprint, whether that's Scotland, UK or any other country around the world. It's a big issue to try and get hold of, just in terms of how we report that. And how we calculate it is very much work in progress for us. So I think I'm agreeing with you, Mark, that we don't understand it well enough. We do need to, because it has major implications in terms of how we impact on the world. We don't just offshore problems, that we actually solve them going forward. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yep. The Circular Economy Bill has just closed for consultation, and that's the opportunity, I think, for Scotland to use the mechanisms within that bill to decrease our carbon, our ecological and our material footprints. And there are several ways we can do that. One is to design out waste so that we're not producing waste at the end of the system. Increasing recycling and repairability, so when you've got products coming onto the market, making sure that you can actually get them mended. And also putting in place a polluter pays so that at the end of a product's life, that goes back to a manufacturer so that you're not just putting it into landfill where it will just sit for decades. So building those kind of responses into the Circular Economy Act, I think, would be really powerful.
And do you think that's best done on a sector-by-sector approach? So if we're looking at consumption or consumption targets, are there very obvious sectors where the impact in terms of climate and biodiversity is quite acute and we need to focus, and we perhaps have levers in some areas but not in others?
I think it's a good place to start. It's a very practical place to start, but we mustn't lose sight of the overall vision, which is to decrease our material, carbon and ecological networks. If we focus too much on a sector-by-sector approach, there's the risk that we'll miss that overall goal. Mm-hmm. But it's a practical place to start.
Okay. Daniela, do you wish to come in on this? Or?
Yeah, just briefly, one example that I think needs to be further thought through, you know, in terms of, it's very difficult. I agree with Colin and Deborah on the challenges and also the way forward and where to start. But just one example that we need to think further is, you know, for example, you mentioned renewables and electric cars, for example, and then what does that mean, you know, in terms of deep seabed mining, for example? That could be, a lot of arguments has been used in terms of we need to start deep seabed mining because we need the minerals for electric cars and all of that. Is that so? Further investigating if that's true, if recycling could be an alternative, and what is the methodologies that need to be put in place to make sure that recycling is an option of those materials or broader and in-depth discussion about those trade-offs, I think, is needed.
Yep. Dr. Mitchell, do you want to come in on this?
Just to quickly agree with Colin about the risk of potentially offshoring our biodiversity footprint. There was a statistic I read the other day that I think implied the UK was the fifth worst country in terms of exporting its biodiversity footprint to other countries. So while we try and improve things within Scotland or the UK, we need to make sure that obviously we don't have unintended consequences abroad.
Yeah. Thanks for that point. Back to you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Monica, I think you've got some questions.
Thank you, Convener. It's been great to have so many experts with us today, so it's been a really fascinating session. I wanted to ask about the Global Biodiversity Framework. So we know that the targets seek to integrate action to tackle climate and nature crises together. So, you know, we all understand that these are indeed interlinked. I wonder if we could maybe hear some examples of the sort of obligations that these targets create in practice in terms of how countries seek to tackle the climate and nature crises together. So maybe just come round the panel, starting with you, Daniela.
Yeah, well, those targets are policy instruments. They're not legally binding per se, but they were adopted under the framework of the convention, which is an international treaty. So one could think that, yeah, it provides for the means of implementation of the convention and the obligations contained under the convention. They need to be taken very seriously. Of course, they're political commitments, but to implement legally binding obligations that they have under the convention and also under other conventions like UNFCCC on climate and law of the sea, on oceans and others, convention on migratory species and so on. So examples is that they're quite broad and wide in range, which is really great. So they bring together means to implement legally binding frameworks, like in a way that they haven't done that before. So there's a lot of, for example, language around ecological connectivity across the GBF that helps not only implement the obligations under the Convention on Biological Diversity, but also the Convention on Migratory Species. There are commitments around trade and supply chains and so on that can help achieve obligations under the CITES Convention on Trade of Endangered Species. It helps implement the obligations under the Law of the Sea in terms of protection of the marine environment through the 30 by 30, and also the Convention on Biological Diversity, its obligations on in situ conservation, and also sustainable use under Article 10 of the Convention. So all of the other targets that we refer to are also contributing to sustainable use of biodiversity, not only the protection of that 30%. And so it puts in place a good framework for actually achieving global legally binding obligations under a number of different conventions, not only the Convention on Biological Diversity.
Thank you, Daniela. Colin?
I'm thinking of a very couple of practical examples. You know, if we meet 2030 in terms of the protected area target and do that terrestrial and marine, but a couple of examples, you know, if we expand our peatland area, for example, then we will get the double whammy, if you like, of better, you know, more and better nature, more and better carbon, potentially, you know, linking into an economic argument in there as well. So there is a multiple win here that, when you take the 20 by 30 target, it looks quite stark. You know, it's just a number. But actually, when you look at the potential that's behind that, either in peatland or in woodland, the same example, you know, if we expanded our native woodlands and our native woodland protected areas, allowed natural regeneration that Deborah took us into in terms of deer management, then you would have a resilient ecosystem, which is really important because with climate change comes greater disease risk. And we've seen that in monocultures around the world. Where you have a monoculture woodland or a monoculture anything, it tends to be really quite vulnerable to disease and to massive disease outbreaks as well. So in woodland, getting back to larger, more connected, better managed protected areas across the UK and across Europe, actually, you would get a more resilient system that actually would benefit locally as well. So you could have local woodland management, you would have ecotourism behind that as well. So what looks like quite stark and you know, academic, if you like, on paper, when you begin to try and translate that into on-the-ground action, there are multiple benefits there. And I come back to, in Scotland, I think we're actually pretty good at showing that to the rest of the world. And it's that kind of example, peatland restoration, for example, I would argue that we really do lead the world in terms of what we're doing. We can do a lot more, but actually it's about turning the agreement here into something that's very real, that benefits us all going forward. So I'm, in that sense, I'm quite optimistic we could do it.
Thank you. Deborah. if
we look at the four goals of the Global Biodiversity Framework, I think it very clearly maps out what our obligations will be in implementing them. If we look at increasing the area of natural ecosystems, then that is clearly an obligation to improve the extent and condition of natural ecosystems so they can function more effectively into the future, into the long-term future, say 100 years from now. That relates back to climate change, obviously. There's the restoring habitats and ecosystems and the species that live there. There's an obligation there to be doing more than we're already doing at the moment. One area where I think we need to put more energy into is in the sharing the benefits. So the third goal is to share the monetary and non-monetary benefits. And I think we could be doing more in terms of how local communities benefit from action on nature and climate change. Colin's absolutely right, we need to do both together. And then the final one is on implementing. How do we implement all of this? Obviously, we need the finance. We've already talked about that. We also need, I think we do need the political will and leadership. We need to see that this is a commitment from government and that together we are going to act and save and help promote and save Scotland's amazing wildlife and landscapes. But then, as part of that, government can't do it on its own. It's not just about doing this. It's about enabling and supporting all of civic society to come on that journey as well. So I think there's another big piece there, a part of an obligation in order to be able to ensure that we implement the four goals as we go along. And just one last thing, the avian flu outbreak has really illustrated the impact of what's happening at the moment. It's clearly an emergency and it's clearly getting bigger and it's getting worse. And what that does is it really highlights the need for us to step up on nature restoration, not just at sea, but also on land. And the avian flu is a really big wake-up call, I think, for us all to muck in, really, and get on this journey together.
Thank you. That's a really important point. I'll come next to Ruth, please.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, broadly speaking, I think it goes back to the points I was making at the beginning, that to address both the climate and the biodiversity crisis, we need to mainstream biodiversity across all the different sectors. I think that's a word that all the panellists have said repeatedly throughout this session, is the importance of getting that mainstreaming across the different sectors. We need to address what we call the indirect drivers, so the societal drivers, the government drivers, the politics, the institutions, so that our policies are really joined up and that biodiversity is addressed in our agricultural policies and in our forestry policies as well. We've already said that our targets need to be smart, so I just reiterate that again. And yeah, again, reiterating the importance of funding. And I think that's really important that we have funding to conserve what we've got at the moment, but also to restore habitats and species. And then finally, obviously, to fund the research that we need to do to monitor that biodiversity and to find out how those direct and indirect drivers of biodiversity impacting biodiversity. And just perhaps a couple of specific examples of where climate change and biodiversity sort of link up. There's been a lot of examples of woodlands often chosen as an example of how you can meet both the climate and the biodiversity targets. And it can, but I think we need to be really careful, as the others have said, about the right tree in the right place, because the wrong tree in the wrong place can have negative impacts for both biodiversity and climate. And we need to be aware of the other habitats we've got in Scotland that can also benefit climate and biodiversity. A lot of our soils store a lot of carbon, and many of our soils in Scotland are very carbon rich. So not just our peatlands, but our other soils on our heather moorlands are also very carbon rich. So we need to be aware of the carbon that we're storing in that, and then also the biodiversity that's important on some of those upland moorlands, like some of our breeding waders and things. So there's just a couple of examples there of some very specific Scottish habitats. But, you know, yeah, but our native woodlands can conserve a lot of biodiversity as well. So it's that balance. I'll stop there.
Thank you, Ruth. That's really helpful. And you said about the right tree in the right place. I'll also declare an interest that I have as the Parliament's nature champion for oak. My next question is around the EU's nature restoration law. So if I may, I might just stay with you, Ruth, and if others in the panel want to contribute, please just catch my eye. So the committee has previously heard from stakeholders about the significance of the development of the EU's nature restoration law. I wonder to what extent you are monitoring the development of EU law in your different institutions. Are there areas where the EU is showing particular ambition or are notable in terms of how they might translate COP15 outcomes? And where should Scotland be seeking to keep pace? If you're able to help with that set of questions, Ruth, that would be helpful.
I think the other panellists might be better placed to answer it than me, but generally I think the EU is showing considerable ambition in the restoration laws, and I think Scotland would do really well to try and match that ambition that's coming out of those restoration laws, so that would be my hope.
Thank you for that very succinct answer. No one's catching my eye. Colin, would you like to have a go?
Just briefly, I mean, in JNCC we try to keep an eye on good law developing in any country, not just in the EU now. I mean, we do genuinely take a global look at it. So very happy in future, to help in any aspect of that. I think the restoration side of it is really, really important. And I come back to the twin emergencies between climate and nature loss. It's, restoration is going to be fundamentally important, but we need to be very clear what we're restoring back to. And that may challenges in terms of the future, in terms of what the parts of the countryside should look like or will look like. And I think collectively and globally, we've not really seized yet the profound change that climate change is bringing. We've seen the beginnings of it, but not the main part of it. And I'm not sure we've yet grappled the whole profound nature loss that we're seeing globally in terms of the need for restoration. So in a limited resource world, I think there are big challenges there about restoration, how we prioritise and how we target. But we're certainly on the case in terms of keeping an eye on the legislation that you talk about.
Thank you, Colin. And you'll probably be aware of the current revision process ongoing in the European Parliament currently with regards to the Directive on Protection of the Environment through the criminal law. Several committees have recommended the inclusion of a crime of ecocide in this directive as part of the revision process. Is this an area of law that Scotland needs to be proactively looking at in terms of keeping pace? Do you have a view on that?
I think one of the areas I looked at years ago was one or two South American countries who have a right of wildlife law. And I think I'm right in saying that Ecuador in particular have a right of wildlife law. Now, that is really radical and really revolutionary. But they, in that particular case, I think it came through the Galapagos Islands, which are quite unique. Global resource. So there are examples around the world of different legal frameworks being put in place. I think we need to be very clear on the purpose of any such law going forward. And I think much of what we do in nature conservation is based on the voluntary principle in terms of collaboration, in terms of partnership. And maybe that, in terms of restoration, is a very good principle to hang on to. Going forward. But, you know, I say again, we're very happy to help if we can give any further information on law from other countries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Monica. There's still quite a few questions to go, and time is short, so it flies when you're having fun. So, Jackie, some questions from you, and then I'm going to go to Mark, and then I'm going to come to Mercedes.
My question kind of follows on from what Monica was saying, so I will leave it in your hands about who best answers it, since time's short. But it was regarding, Monica mentioned the EU, but I was wanting to find out about the best practice, international best practice on biodiversity. What does it look like? Did COP15 manage to shine a light on the international best practice of governance? I'm not sure who would be, or could more be done?
I was struggling to work out who's going to answer. So maybe if I could help you, if I come to Daniela and then go to Colin, and then I'm afraid we'll have to move on to our next question. Is that all right?
Yeah, I don't think that COP15 managed to shed a light on that yet, because we're just developing. So we'll see that in the reports that come back. So the first report on the implementation of the GBF are due, the first cycle of the reports is due in 2026. So that's when we'll have a better sense. Of course, there has been assessments by the Global Biodiversity Outlook. The last one was Global Biodiversity Outlook 5 that looked at implementation of the Aichi biodiversity targets, so the set of targets that came before, but that was more on a global level and an aggregated way. So we'll have national reports and on the GBF specifically in 2026. And I think that there is no country that does better in biodiversity overall. I think that in some sectors, in some instances, in some habitats, they can do better than others, but it's a mixed match. But that's my opinion.
So they could learn from each other.
Yeah.
Just briefly, I mean, I think it is interesting. I mean, what does best practice look like? I think there's something in nature conservation now about very clear targets, real delivery, a clear overview in terms of context, where does that fit, and then government support and potential funding. The key part of that, I think, is community buy-in. It's actually getting ownership locally and regionally for what's being done, whether that's oak woodlands in Argyll or whether it's upland areas in Aberdeenshire. So that community buy-in is really important. And I think some of the areas that I've looked at previously are in what you would call the developing world in Africa. And actually there are some really good examples of community ownership, buy-in, government support in Africa. But you could argue actually we're moving in that direction as well. There are great examples of community buy-in in parts of Scotland in terms of nature conservation management. So I think one thing that would be really helpful is to pull together a list of good examples that would genuinely answer your question perhaps better than we have today. But we shouldn't always jump and look abroad. I think what we're doing here is actually fantastic across Scotland and across the UK. You know, we have a Nature of Scotland Award, I think, every November. And when you see what's been done by local communities at that, it's an award ceremony, it's the Oscars for nature conservation. But when you see the enthusiasm from children in schools around the country or local communities, then we are doing an awful lot really well. We could do more, but let's look at home as well as abroad.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Mark, you've got a question, then I'm going to come to
the second. Yeah, thanks, Convener. My final question is, I think, predominantly for yourself, Colin. And it's about the role of the JNCC in terms of providing that UK-wide governance in relation to these international agreements that we're signed up to. And then I think slightly separately to that, just again, the JNCC's role in terms of cooperation. So we have a very live example of that, which we're considering at the moment as a committee with the Energy Bill and the establishment of offshore wind mitigation and a lot of complexities there over devolved and reserved boundaries. Sure. So without opening up a huge can of worms, could you just address briefly those two points around governance and how cooperation work with the JNCC?
Sure. I mean, JNCC is a UK body. It's the committee that I chair. I've chaired it now for 2 and a bit years. It's made up of the four countries. So Nature Scot have got 2 representatives on the committee, England, Wales, Northern Ireland. And then we have 5 independent members. I'm the independent chair. So we are genuinely a body of the 4 countries of the UK. Our remit is very much UK, overseas territories and international. And I think what I'm keen that we do is that we take examples from around the UK and take that into the international arena, as well as translating back down from agreements like CBD into the 4 countries. So we're very much of that making, as it were. And it's very much a partnership between the 4 countries. And that's something that I'm very keen to encourage, that we actually take account of what's happening in the 4 countries rather than just being top down. Then we're bottom up as well, if I can put it that way. In terms of cooperation, then, we do work extremely closely with the 4 countries on marine issues in particular. Our remit is really beyond the 12-mile limit. It's the countries will manage most of what's within the 12-mile limit. Our input and expertise is very much beyond that in terms of marine protected areas, renewables, etc. But we do work a devolved system where countries are increasingly dealing with developers in particular offshore areas. So the working arrangement right now is really constructive and very positive. I think there's also an efficiency in there in terms of the collective scientific expertise that we can deploy along with colleagues in Nature Scot or NRW in Wales or wherever. So I'm very happy to follow up discussions with you about that, if that's helpful.
Can I just ask, have you advised the UK government in relation to the Energy Bill offshore wind mitigation?
We have and are involved in the UK government discussions about that, yes.
Okay. Okay. I mean, if there's anything you can forward to the committee on that matter, it would be very useful as well. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. And if you are going to forward it, can I just remind you to do it to the clerks and then we can all get sight of it. Mercedes, you've been sitting very quietly and patiently. I think you've got some questions.
Yes, thank you, Karina, and thank you to the committee for accommodating my involvement today. So I'd like to ask a couple of questions, depending on time. The first relates to a point that Dr. Deborah Long made regarding the need to mainstream the targets across different policy areas and sectors, though I think other witnesses have mentioned that too. So if we could hear from Deborah Long first, then potentially the others if there's time. So I'd like to know what role you see for land reform in ensuring successful implementation of the COP15 outcomes in Scotland, and if there are any specific interventions around this that your organisation would like to see.
Yeah, that's a big one. So in terms of mainstreaming, I think the only way that we're going to meet the targets, both of the Global Biodiversity Framework and the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, is to mainstream across planning, for example, so that MPF4 takes account of biodiversity as well as meeting net zero. So I think there's a balance. It's not a balance. We need to do both. So we can't do one at the expense of the other. So that's one area. In terms of land reform specifically, there are two elements to it. It's ensuring that land management on behalf of the nation is contributing both towards net zero and towards meeting the biodiversity targets. I think that's a really important principle that needs to be part of the land reform discussion. But then I'm also going to come back to the involving local communities so that they benefit too. So that it's not just the planet that benefits, but local communities benefit as well. We see that already through wind farm locations on land, for example. How are we going to build a process that ensures that local communities benefit too from flood management, from woodland creation, from whatever the nature solution might be? How do we ensure that they benefit too? So I think there are those two principles that needs to be kind of a golden thread through land reform as we go forward.
Thank you very much. I don't know if we could put it to, if any of the other witnesses would like to.
It's not really for us in JNCC to comment on land reform, actually, in a sense. But when you look at nature conservation around the world, how land is managed becomes really important, and maybe that's slightly separate from ownership. So you can see good examples and bad examples around the world of nature conservation on a whole suite of land ownership scenarios. So for us, management and monitoring of that in terms of the effectiveness of that becomes really the better way to look at it.
Thanks very much.
Questions?
Yeah, so the other question relates to a couple of comments earlier on as well. One comment was around the role of private financing, and then I think we heard from Dr. Long about the need for, I think it was 980,000 hectares of land, you said, needed to be protected for nature. And so I'd be interested to hear how you think we can ensure that that target for land protected for nature can work in harmony with our other needs as a nation in terms of food security and economic resilience for rural communities. How can they work together?
That's a big one. Sorry.
You've got 30 seconds. No, but reasonably, it's a huge question, that. But if you'd like to tackle part of it and then probably come to Colin and briefly to Ruth and see if we can get an answer to Ty. And Daniela, at a push, I won't exclude you. So,
I think the short answer is it comes back to the same principle of right management, right place. So it's not a case of we just do one thing with a piece of land. Land can do can lead to multiple benefits. So I think it's where are those multiple benefits? And food production is one of them. It's not just about producing food. It's also about conserving biodiversity and putting carbon into the soil or into the vegetation, whatever it happens to be. So I think there's multiple benefits. How can we maximise that? But also how can we minimise any negatives? So any negative land management that's contributing to carbon emissions or contributing to the decline of biodiversity, those are the ones that we need to tackle. And in relation to hazardous subsidies, I know that was one of the targets that came out, that's a really key point. So there's the agriculture, but there's also forestry. Forestry could be doing much, much more in order to build carbon and to maintain and restore biodiversity.
And so can I ask just a very brief follow-up? So you do believe that it's possible on one piece of land to not only protect nature but also produce food, maybe produce resources like wood, for example, for building materials?
Absolutely. We've got agroforestry, agroecology, we've got organic farming. Those are just three examples off the top of my head.
Thank you.
Colin.
Very, very briefly. I mean, I think what's interesting is some of the really good examples of nature restoration and nature management in Scotland and across the UK now are actually privately funded. So there is actually a lot of private money coming in to nature recovery for a multitude of reasons. So in terms of the overall question, is it possible to get multiple benefits from the same area of land? Absolutely, I agree with Deborah that it's about how that land is managed and the long-term view that's taken in terms of managing land as well. So private finance, I think, is important to deliver the targets here, and that's good. I think there are examples in Scotland that could be used internationally about how it can be done. And yes, there's more to do on agriculture and forestry.
Ruth, do you want to come in briefly?
Yeah, just to say, I totally agree that you can get multiple benefits from the same piece of land. For example, at the Hutton, there's been work done on intercropping and sowing different species mixtures together. that can benefit not just the cropping yield, but also the biodiversity. And also I'd say that if we have a more diverse land with different habitats, the systems are generally more resilient. It goes back to what Colin was saying about if you have monocultures of things, then you're more at risk from either changes in climate or from pests and pathogens. So if you've got that mixture of species, be that different habitats or different crops within your farming system or within your woodland, then your system's going to be more resilient as well as delivering more benefits.
Daniela, briefly.
Yes, I agree with previous speakers. Agroecology has been mentioned. It's included in one of the targets as well. Organic farming, I think, as well. I'm not an expert on terrestrial ecosystems, but I know those practices. And in the marine ecosystem, just an example, in the Northwest Atlantic, the Northwest Atlantic Fisheries Organization, which the UK is a member state, have recently adopted in September last year a threshold for ecosystem level fisheries, which is a groundbreaking methodology and also decision-making tool for implementing the ecosystem approach to fisheries, which at times can be quite elusive and difficult to implement on the ground. And I think that example can provide a lot of insight for other regions as well, including for Scotland. And that is a mechanism where both food security and biodiversity can coexist.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, those of you that are observant will have seen that I haven't asked a question at all during this panel. I've saved mine to the end. And interestingly, it leads directly on from the last question, so it is perfectly placed. Having spent 40 years of my life doing environmental management, one thing I've learned is you can't be all things to all people, and you can't be all things to all species. So, for example, managing capercaillie in Abernethy Forest can't be done without control of pine martens, which are the biggest threat to capercaillie, and we spent millions of pounds on it. Similarly, I'm taken by Deborah's comment about deer. It's about carrying capacity, and the capacity not being the one that damages the environment. Sheep are as big a threat in my mind, as are hares on the high montane places of Scotland, who will clip the heather and the blueberries to such an extent that they can't grow. And therefore, management is a difficult balance. So on the basis that I'm not wanting to make Scotland exclusive for any species or see it being made exclusive for any species, I think there is room for zoning where we accept that we can achieve things for different species in different zones, therefore making it overall, as on a national basis, that we are achieving something for all of Scotland. A quick yes or no answer would suffice, but I suspect I may not get it from the panel. And I'll just go round the table to ask whether if panellists feel that zoning could play a part in ensuring species and habitat enhancement across Scotland. And Ruth, why don't you start? You're remotely, and then I'll work round the table from Deborah through to Daniela.
Thank you. Yes, I think zoning essentially could, if you think of it in terms of a land use strategy. So I think it's really important to have a land use strategy that's also got an implementation plan.
Thank you. Deborah.
It's really difficult. I think zoning, if you're talking about protected areas, for example, you could argue that a national park is a zone, even though it's got very different land management systems within it. I think the key issue is an issue that Ruth mentioned earlier, actually. Diversity is the key to resilience moving forward, and we need our ecosystems to be much, much more resilient than they are at the moment, and that resilience won't be achieved through monocultures. So I think bringing diversity into every system and every zone, if you wanted to call it that, is absolutely key to making sure that we will restore biodiversity and halt climate emissions and actually have a livable planet going forward. So I think if you can manage diversity within your zones to maximise connectivity, then yes, but connectivity and diversity is the key for me.
Colin.
It's an interesting concept and not one that I really thought greatly about, I have to say, in the way you've explained it. I mean, we do have natural zones across the UK in terms of habitat climate. And I think to look at the management within each of these is something that happens anyway, would be very interesting. So I'm going to duck out a bit and say I'd really quite like to take that concept away and think about it a bit more in terms of what it would mean. Diversity is important. Linking to local communities is important. So you don't want communities not to be able to experience the full range of Scottish, UK biodiversity in their particular part of the country. So it's an interesting concept. We do have zones. Let's think a little bit more about it, if that's not too academic an answer.
Daniela.
I think it is a tool, but I agree with Deborah that diversity should be mainstreamed across it as well. I know that in the marine environment, for example, in the context of when you think of marine spatial planning, there is that inherited tendency to think that it includes zoning. And I know that my experience in Canada, for example, is that marine spatial planning couldn't involve zoning per se, because some sectors wouldn't agree with that. Although when you think about, you know, offshore or wind or so on, it has some element of zoning. So it is, I can't give you an yes or no answer, but it is a tool. But biodiversity mainstreaming is important in that.
I'm interested, and I'll be interested to hear, Colin, in due course, whether you take from it. I mean, the resilience is really important. And, you know, to hear that we're now at the stage where in southern Scotland we may have reached maximum golden eagle numbers is really exciting to me. And yes, we need to spread that out across the country, but it needs to be done in a way that ensures biodiversity. So thank you. It's been a really interesting panel. I could have spent all morning asking all the questions. I think we all could have done. And I thank you very much for your contribution. And I'm now briefly going to suspend the meeting to allow us to set up for the next bit. Thank you. Okay, thank you. We're now going to move back to agenda item three, which is consideration of petition PE1866. This petition was lodged by Daryl Cooper in May 2021, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to introduce legislation so that wheelchair users are able to face frontwards while travelling in a bus. I refer members to the paper for this item, which provides some background information and outlines possible action. At our meeting on the 1st of November 2022, the committee considered the petition and agreed to keep it open. The committee agreed to write to COSLA to ask how local authorities were delivering improvements for wheelchair users on public transport. It also agreed to make representations to the UK government on its upcoming review of the rules which govern accessibility on public transport. I'm now going to turn to committee members for your views, noting in particular the options that are set out in paragraph 18 of the paper, which are to keep the petition and await the outcome of the review by the public sector vehicles accessibility regulations, which are expected later this year, before agreeing further action, or to close the petition on the basis that the committee has exhausted all the options to progress the petition at this stage. But we could also agree a part of this to write to the House of Commons Transport Select Committee, who are undertaking an inquiry on accessible transport, to inform them of the petition and the concerns it highlights, and ask them to let us know the outcome of their inquiry. Are there any views from members in relation to this? Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and I think the petition raises really important issues, and I know that I think we'll all be grateful to the petitioner for the work that they have done. It's a little bit frustrating. I feel it would be good if we could do more at this committee, but I understand the reasons why and recognise that it will be looked at in the House of Commons. So I think it is important that we write to the Transport Select Committee just to consolidate the work that has been done here and the views that we've obtained, and hopefully they can keep us informed.
Okay, thank you. Deputy Convener.
I agree with that. I think the issue has been brought to our attention. We've brought it to other relevant authorities' attention. The issue of legislation, which was the point of the petition, is reserved. But I do think, in writing to the House of Commons Transport Select Committee, if they are looking, as it's suggested, that they will be looking at the issue of accessible transport, we draw to their attention that issue specifically about front-facing wheelchair users, and ask if they can come back to us once they've conducted their inquiry. But I think our job as a committee has probably come to a reasonable conclusion at this point.
Okay, I'm just looking around committee members. I think we're all agreed, and Monica was agreed as well, is that we should write to the committee, make them aware of our concerns in this area and of the petition, and ask them to inform us of the outcome so that we can consider this in the process. But this has come to a natural conclusion as far as the petition is concerned, and therefore we should close it. Obviously, writing to the petitioner to ensure that they're aware of what we're doing and why we've done it. So is the committee agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. That concludes our public meeting, and we're now going to go into private session.